Thank you. Christ our Lord. We welcome you to worship here at First United Methodist Church, and we're so glad that you have joined us either in person or online for our service of worship this morning. This is the sixth Sunday in the season of Easter, so we continue in the season of Easter, and we are always Easter people. If you are a guest worshiping with us today, we extend a special welcome to you and are so glad that you have joined us. We invite you to take the pew pads, the friendship pads. They are on the center aisle end of your pew, and to register that you are present with us. You also have an opportunity on the pew pads to share other information with us, updated contact information or prayer requests or other information that you need for us to know. You'll find in your bulletin that there are two inserts. One of those alerts you that this is Graduate Sunday, and so we are just filled with joy to celebrate and honor the graduates in the class of 2022. And the other insert is from Habitat for Humanity and shares with you that the communities of faith in Gaston County are joining together to build a Habitat House. Invite you to read the insert and learn more about that opportunity for service. It is good that we are together for worship. God's Spirit joins us, and now we prepare our hearts for worship. Please stand in either body or spirit and join me in our call to worship. From water and the Spirit, life is born.
Water and the Spirit, new life begins.
By water and the Spirit, eternal life is sustained.
Let us celebrate being born anew by Christ and worship God.
Let us sing together. As we pass the peace of Christ this morning, let us extend signs of welcome and friendship to one another. Our scripture reading.
Thank you. Is this working? No, I didn't think so.
Okay, stay there. Keep talking.
How do I make it work?
You don't.
I don't. Okay. Now it is. The Psalter reading this morning is Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us. May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
For children's time. Okay, so who remembers seeing this? Lots of you probably had one. What did we do with these?
You keep butterflies in them when they come out of their chrysalis.
Mm-hmm, that's right. We did these at Easter. And what did it start out as?
As an open and egg. And then it flew out.
And they fly out, that's right. So they start out. That's right. Well, look. What did they start out as? What did you say?
Egg.
Yeah, that little egg, and then it's a
caterpillar.
Then a chrysalis. Uh-huh. And after
the butterfly
did what?
He flew off.
Flew away. Well, today you are gonna hear. You're gonna hear in our sermon about being born anew. And so just like this caterpillar goes into that chrysalis, and when it comes out, it's something new, right? And we can be born again. We can be born anew through Jesus. And we can leave all that old behind us. But that's only through Jesus, okay? And so you're going to hear that today. So you can be just like that caterpillar and be born anew into something even more beautiful. So do we want to pray and tell God thank you for that? All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you so, so much for your great love and the fact that we can be born anew in you. Help us to just stay close to you. We love you, God. Amen. Thank you, friends.
Good morning. My name is Stephanie Jenkins. I am the Director of Student Ministries here, and I am very excited that today is graduation Sunday. And we have wonderful students to recognize this morning. As you know, in the last couple of years, they've gone through highs and lows more than usual as previous classes. And so we want to thank them for their presence, their gifts, and all that they bring to us. So I'm going to announce them by name, and I will give a short benediction after they all come up to the front. So a few are not here this morning, but our first person is Lane Alexandra Maitra, and she currently attends Forest View High School, and she will be going to Catawba College to study biochemistry and be on the soccer team there. Next is Carson Michael Moran. He also attends Forest View High School, and his next step is NC State, where he will study aerospace engineering and be a National Naval ROTC midshipman. Next is Jackson Carl Smith, also attending Forest View High School, and he will be going to Western Carolina University and study music education. And last but not least is Tate Walker Smith, and he attends Forest View High School, and he will be going to UNC Chapel Hill to study finance and economics. So let's give these guys a round of applause. So, we're very proud of these individuals, and for those that are also in the insert bulletin that could not be with us today. It's very an emotional time when they are closing one chapter but beginning anew. And so I want to share this benediction by Reverend James Moyers, followed by the youth benediction. As your classes and grading come to a close, may you strive toward excellence in all you do. As the speeches conclude, may your voices rise up to pronounce justice and peace in the world. As the fanfare cease, may you sing of joy, even in the dark and lonely places. As the applause quiets, may you celebrate and lift up those around you. As you graduate, may your achievements grow and cause growth in your communities. And may we all know of the overwhelming blessings of the one who created all things. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
I invite us now into a time of prayer as we join our hearts as one. Our circle of prayer is included in our bulletin each and every week. Invite you to take that with you. Take it and place it in the place at home where you spend time in prayer and devotion so that you can be in prayer with and for all the names and circumstances on this list. If you have other prayer requests that you wish to share, we invite you to share those with us, whether they be printed on the list or whether we receive those confidentially. Send us an email, a phone call, or use the form that's on our church website so that we can be in prayer together. You might have other joys or concerns that are on your heart and on your mind today. I will offer us a moment of silence so that you can take an opportunity to lift those to God in prayer, and then I will offer a prayer for us together. Let us pray. God of all life and love, we praise you for this beautiful Sabbath day of worship and rest. God, we are in awe of your great love for us, love so strong, love so selfless that you gave of your only Son. Thanks to the power of your love and grace, There is nothing that can separate us from you, no relationship that cannot be restored, and no end to life that is lived in you. Occasionally, though, God, we find ourselves bound up by chains of mistrust. Sometimes darkness and fear hold us in place, and we need to let you turn on the light for us and show us the way. Some days we are afraid to hope because we have hoped before and have been disappointed. Forgive our stubbornness, God. Forgive us when we resist your deep mercy. Truly, we do know that you are making all things new and that you include us in this promise and in this holy work. So come, Holy Spirit, we invite you to renew us day by day. As we pray together as one body, we lift up our prayers of thanksgiving and joy. Just this week, there have been moments that have brought us great joy. There have been conversations, friendships, laughter and tears, beauty that we have seen in the world around us, and prayers that have been answered. We realize that all of these are your good gifts, and we take pause so that we can say thank you for all of your blessings, great and small. As we pray together, we also lift up prayers of intercession for others. We lift up your children who are near and far and who carry heavy burdens and feel as though they cannot put them down. Burdens like illness, like debt, addiction, caregiving, fear, grief, racism, war, and many others. We trust, God, that you know all of our burdens, that you even take them upon yourself. And so we pray you would provide comfort and healing to all of your children who are so weary. On this Graduate Sunday, we want to thank you for this group of young adults in the class of 2022. We celebrate all of the unique gifts you have given them, and we give thanks for the family members, the teachers, the mentors, the friends, and others who have guided them along their journey. As they prepare for the next season of their lives, we pray for them. We ask that you give them wisdom, faith, and joy as they build upon the foundation they have already laid. We hope that they know that even as they go out into the world, they can always come back home. Finally, God, we continue to daily lift up prayers for our community, for the world, and for our church. May we be one as you are one. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, who is our risen Lord, and we join our voices as one in the prayer he has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we continue in worship this morning, one of our acts of worship, our spiritual acts, is to give our offerings, our tithes, and our gifts, returning to God a portion of what God has first gifted and trusted to us. Your faithfulness and your generosity, it supports and sustains ministries of this church that flow from us out into the community and the world, forming and raising up young, old, new disciples and touching hearts and minds and lives.
and down the wall. Let us join our hearts as one. Love has broken down the wall.
God, whose love has broken down every wall, accept these gifts offered in faith and love and put them to work in the world to bring about your heavenly kingdom here on the earth. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
So good morning. Let me offer my own personal congratulations to our graduates this morning, and my prayers go with you, and may you seize all that life has to offer you as you continue this journey which God has given you. So let us hear these words of Scripture this morning. I'm reading from the Gospel of John, and I would ask that you stand as you're able for the Gospel reading. I'll be reading from Eugene Peterson's translation, The Message. There was a man of the Pharisee sect, Nicodemus, a prominent leader among the Jews. Late one night, he visited Jesus and he said, "Rabbi, we all know you're a teacher straight from God. No one could do all that God-pointing, God-revealing acts you do if God were in on it all." Jesus said, "You're absolutely right. Take it from me. Unless a person is born from above, it's not possible to see what I'm pointing to God's kingdom." "How can anyone," said Nicodemus, "be born who has already been born and grown up? You can't re-enter your mother's womb and be born again. What are you saying with this born from above talk?" Jesus said, "You're not listening. Let me say it again. Unless a person submits to this original creation, the wind hovering over the water creation, the invisible moving the visible, a baptism into a new life, it's not possible to enter God's kingdom. When you look at a baby, it's just that, a body you can look at and touch. But the person who takes shape within is formed by something you can't see and touch, the Spirit, and becomes a living spirit. So don't be so surprised when I tell you that you have to be born from above, out of this world, so to speak. You know well enough how the wind blows this way and that. You hear it rustling through the trees, but you have no idea where it comes from or where it's headed next. That's the way it is with everyone born from above by the wind of God, the Spirit of God." Nicodemus asks, "What do you mean by this? How does this happen?" And Jesus said, "You're a respected teacher of Israel, and you don't know these basics? Listen carefully. I'm speaking sober truth to you. I speak only what I know by experience. I give witness only to what I have seen with my own eyes. There is nothing secondhand here, no hearsay. Yet instead of facing the evidence and accepting it, you procrastinate with questions. If I tell you things that are as plain as the hand before your face, and you don't believe me, what use is there in telling you of things you can't see, the things of God? No one has ever gone up into the presence of God except the one who came down from that presence, the Son of Man. In the same way that Moses lifted the serpent in the desert so people could have something to see and then believe, it is necessary for the Son of Man to be lifted up. And everyone who looks up to Him, trusting and expectant, will gain a real life, eternal life. This is how much God loved the world. He gave His Son, this one and only Son. And this is why, so that no one need be destroyed, by believing in Him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending His Son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it was. He came to help, to put the world right again." It's the Word of God for the people of God, and the people say, "Thanks be to God." And you may be seated. And I would ask that you turn your eyes towards the screens.
"How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
Again.
"How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
Once more.
"How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
That's the way to come into our room.
"Mr. Bash, you are stunning."
"Go on, Ernestine. Say it to her like you've been practicing. Go on."
"How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
"Good, good."
"Are you all set? I brought the car to drive you over to Mrs. Wiley's."
"Good."
"Hi, Aunt B."
"Hi."
"Hi there. Well, where's old Ernest T? I want to get a good look." "Ernest T!
How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
"Oh, is that a good time?"
"What do you think, huh?"
"Andy, you're a genius. I didn't even know him. You've created a new person. You've taken a raw piece of clay and you've molded it into a... Well, you're just a genius." "That's good, Ernest T. Good."
"How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
"Can he say anything besides how do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
"Well, sure. Talk to Barney, Ernestine."
"Good evening."
"Good, good."
"Good." "Nice evening, ain't it? May I have these dines?" "Thank you for the dines." "May I have the next dines?" "No coffee, tea, or punch, thank you."
"Tell me all about yourself."
"How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?"
"Yes. Have you and the sheriff been having a nice visit? What have you been doing in town?"
"Well, I've been coming into rooms nice. I ain't been shaking ladies' hands.
Oh, now be serious. No, thank you, Mildred.
No coffee, tea, or punch, thank you.
Ernest T, you're coming off like $1 million.
Hi, Ernest T.
How do you do, Mrs. Wiley?
No, you said that. Now, get a girl and dance a little.
Well.
Now, you see that girl right over there? Her name is Ramona. Now, go ask her to dance with you.
Well, I don't know.
Now, you want to know girls, don't you? Well, go on, dance like you've been practicing. Okay, go ahead.
Have I got the rhythm?
Yeah, you got it. Go on.
May I have this danced?
I'd be delighted.
I was right there in it. Cutting in.
Hey, you gonna get away from me this way, aren't
I? Ernest,
put that girl down. Oh, no. It's him. That animal. That creature.
Creature?
Who are you calling a creature?
Excuse us, Miss Wiley.
He wouldn't give me back my chosen woman. It ain't fair. And she called me a creature.
There's nothing better than Andy Griffith, right? Beverly and I visited with my dad on Friday at friends' homes in Greensboro. Dad will turn 89 this week, and so we celebrated his birthday, and I also tried to straighten his TV out for him. He's not too good with the remote, so I got it set up for TV Land and left instructions that Andy Griffith came on every day at 4 o'clock, and there were reruns till 8 o'clock, and that's about all he wanted to watch was Andy Griffith. So there you go. So if you're an Andy Griffith fan, you know that Ernest T would regularly come on the show and wreak havoc in Mayberry, and Andy and Barney were always trying to change, reform, transform, whatever, Ernest T. But Ernest T was always Ernest T, no matter what, as you saw in the video. You could change the outside, you could dress him up, you could give him some lines to say, but in the end, Ernest T never was able to change. He continued to throw rocks through windows and basically terrorize Mayberry and the people in it. There's a story that goes that there was a club in New Orleans. There was a piano in that club, and the musicians that played there were always complaining about the piano. It was out of tune, keys would stick, and they were constantly appealing to the owner of the club to do something about the piano. And so one day, the club owner decided he'd do something about the piano. He painted it. I think you get my point. Piano might have looked a little better, but it's still the same old piano. Sticky keys and out of tune. While the piano looked better, it wasn't different. While Andy and Barney were able to change Ernest T's appearance or outward persona for a period of time, Ernest T always remained the same on the inside. So that got me to thinking this week, especially about Nicodemus. We go to Bible study, we go to Sunday school, we go to worship, we maybe join a small group, we study the Bible, we pray together. But do we ever really allow the gospel to penetrate our lives? I'll say that again. Do we ever allow the gospel to penetrate our lives? Are we changed by Jesus? Or are we just putting new paint on the old piano? The Catholic priest and writer Henry Nouwen, reflecting on the story of Nicodemus, wrote, he said, "I love Jesus, but want to hold on to my friends even when they do not lead me close to Jesus. I love Jesus, but want to hold on to my own independence even when that independence brings me no real freedom. I love Jesus, but do not want to lose the respect of my professional colleagues, even though I know that their respect does not make me grow spiritually. I love Jesus, but do not want to give up my writing plans, travel plans, and speaking plans, even when these plans are often more to the glory of God, or glory to my glory than to the glory of God. So I am like Nicodemus, who came by night and said safe things about Jesus to his colleagues." Jesus tells Nicodemus that he needs to get a new life. He needs to be born from above. Now notice that Jesus doesn't say born again, which Nicodemus is confused about, and we remain confused until this day. We think Jesus says born again, but Jesus says born from above. Jesus tells Nicodemus that he needs to be born from above by water and by the Spirit. To put it more succinctly, Nicodemus needs to change not just his outward appearance, but his inner self. But here's the question. Why would a man like Nicodemus change? Why would we change? So let's start with Nicodemus. By all appearances, Nicodemus has got it made. He has the perfect life, especially for those times. He is a highly, highly respected member of the community. He is educated. Today it would be equivalent of having a master's degree or maybe even a PhD. He has status as a ruling member of the Sanhedrin. He's like a superior court judge, if you will. He's a wealthy man who enjoys rank and privilege and power, position. Now let's be honest. Those are things that are hard to walk away from, right? It's hard to get away from those kinds of things. And outwardly, Nicodemus is a religious man. He goes to synagogue every day. He goes to the temple when he's supposed to go to the temple. I mean, Nicodemus is the kind of person that anyone would envy. Yet we all know that outward appearances, Ernest T., for example, don't always tell the truth, right? You know, sometimes you'll look at a person and you'll say, that person has it made, look at them. But little do you realize what's going on inside. Often there's turmoil and struggle. Nicodemus, though, he's careful. Nicodemus is careful to present himself as one who has his act together. But Jesus sees through it all and he's having none of it. And he looks at Nicodemus and he says, look, you need to change. But old man Nick, he resists. You know, we often find comfort in thinking that the problem, whatever it might be at work, it might be at church, it might be in our family or whatever, we find comfort in thinking that if other people would change, everything would get better, right? Oh man, if that person would just change, everything would be different. I used to operate that way. I used to say, you know, if I could just get this church to change, or individuals in the church to change, if they'd change their attitude, everything would be better. And then, and I'm a little slow, and it took me a while to realize this, that the only person you can change is yourself. And that in changing yourself, you often bring change to the system or to other people. The Jesuit priest and writer and spiritual guide Anthony DeMello says it so well. He writes, "I was a revolutionary when I was young, and my prayer to God was, Lord, give me the energy to change the world. As I approached middle age and realized that half my life was gone without my changing a single soul, I changed my prayer to, Lord, give me the grace to change all those who come in contact with me, just my family and friends, and I'll be satisfied. Now that I am an old man and my days are numbered, why, my one prayer is, Lord, give me the grace to change myself. If I had prayed for this right from the start, I should not have wasted my life." Jesus says we need to be born not again, but from above. The Greek word that Jesus uses is anothen. The word means from above, or from top to bottom, bottom to top, if you will. We need, according to Jesus, the disorienting and revealing wind of the Spirit to blow through our lives, as Jesus suggests to Nicodemus. We need to change from top to bottom and bottom to top. Unfortunately, we do as Anthony DeMello described in my earlier quote, one of my favorite quotes, by the way. What we do is we fiddle with our lives. We just kind of mess around the edges, tweaking this and tweaking that, but never really changing. It's kind of like the car here. It's a car that Beverly and I own, a 67 Oldsmobile 442 convertible. It's the last of my dad's car collection. It's the only one left. I got it several years ago as we were selling off his collection. Dad gave it to us. And since then, I have literally been through every system on the car. I have rebuilt it, trying to keep it on the road. Everything except the engine has something new in it. It's a great car. It's fun to drive, and people admire it when you're going down the road and they beep their horn and they wave at you and they speak at you at the stoplights and that sort of thing. But there's something I know about this car, because I have this car documented all the way to the day it was born. The car originally was bought in Pennsylvania and spent a good chunk of its life there. So, you know, and I know, salt roads in the wintertime, snow and ice. It looks great. But I know in there somewhere, underneath it all, there's rust. There are things that need to be fixed. I mean, for the car to really be like it was when it came off the showroom floor, I'd have to do what people in the car collecting world call a frame-off restoration. I'd literally have to take the car down to its last nut and bolt and build it back again, transform it and make it new again. But I don't do that.
I just keep fiddling with it, fixing this and that, so that I can keep it on the road. And that's what we do. That's what we do. We tinker with our lives. We make small changes here and there so that we can keep going down the road. And all the while, Jesus is saying, you need a frame-off restoration. We need to be born from above. You need to change. You need to change completely. But we're like Nicodemus too when we ask, well, how in the world am I supposed to do that? And Jesus says, well, you need to be open to the Spirit's leading, and the Spirit blows where it will, and you have to be willing to let the Spirit blow you where it will. And I believe, and this is what Jesus is saying, only someone who has truly felt the blowing of the Spirit can understand what Jesus is saying. When you feel it, you know it. Interestingly, Nicodemus must have figured this out at some point later, because Nicodemus shows up briefly at the end of Jesus' life and ministry. And I have to believe, because, you know, I want to think positively about this, that Nicodemus figured it out. And that Nicodemus was changed by those moments that he spent with Jesus in the middle of the night. I also have to believe that the writer of John, the gospel writer, purposefully described this interaction between Nicodemus and Jesus as happening at nighttime, or in the middle of the night. First off, you know, you can imagine that because Nicodemus was concerned about his reputation and everything else, maybe he snuck out in the middle of the night to see Jesus. But I think it's more than that. John wanted his readers to understand that Nicodemus was walking in the dark, figuratively and literally, and that what Nicodemus needed to do was get in touch with God's light. So like Nicodemus, we walk in the shadows. I know I've spent too much time there. Still do sometimes. And the only way to come out of the shadows is to walk to the light of Christ. It's like an article I read several years ago about Bob Kalinske, and you can look it up on Google and read the article yourself, who spent 8 years of his life living in a New York Amtrak tunnel. He was addicted to alcohol and drugs, and then one day he got to thinking that he didn't want to die in that tunnel like all the other people that were living there with him, or so many of the people that were living there with him, or had lived there with him, who had died in that place. And Kalinske decided that he would walk out of the darkness and into the light. Rick Bragg wrote about Kalinske in a 1986 newspaper article. His life was a saga. Out of the darkness into the light is the way Bragg described it. A wonderful example of how lives can change, and how you can make the decision to change. And also the understanding that God never gives up on us. Never, ever. You see, Jesus' life, for me anyway, was about showing people a better way. A better way to live their lives. Or how they could come out of the darkness and into the light. We have to continue We may have begun that journey, but we have to continue to make changes in our life if we want to continue to walk in the light. There is that miracle of the moment when we receive Christ, but a changed life needs to become a life of discipleship. That means we change our patterns of behavior, temper our neurotic responses, redirect our energy, reorder our priorities, and reform our old attitudes. You know, so often people say to me, you know, I was saved on such and such a date, and I always want to ask, well, what have you been doing since then? You know? Because sometimes the person, as I know them, it seems to me that they hadn't been doing anything. Jesus said, by your fruits you will know them. The changes that we make, continue to make in our lives are a sign that we have walked out of the darkness and into the light. They are the fruits of repentance, the fruits of grace, the fruits of the problems we need to settle, the relationships that need mending, words of forgiveness, feelings that we must learn to control, and the mission that we must fulfill. Coming out of the darkness and into the light and following Jesus day in and day out is the way of Christ. That's what Christ was trying to say to Nicodemus. It is obedience, it's devotion. It's not easy, but it is the best way to live your life, as Jesus tries to explain. You see, Jesus' way is, for me anyway, is not getting what we deserve, but getting what we need. The last part of this scripture passage is that passage that we all know so well. You don't quite hear it in this translation, but it's, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son so that we might have life eternal, right? In other words, really, no matter what we do, God is always going to love us. I mean, that's the whole biblical story for me. You know, Moses goes down into Egypt and he brings the people across the Sinai Peninsula, and all they can do is moan and gripe. And he comes down from the mountain with the tablets, and what does he discover? He discovers that they have erected a golden calf, and Moses is so disgusted he throws the tablets down, and God loves them anyway. And eventually they do get to the promised land. In the Old Testament book of Samuel, if you remember, David has an affair with Bathsheba. Does God abandon David? No. God continues to love David. Peter, my favorite disciple, Peter denies knowing Jesus not one time, not two times, but three times. And then Peter, because he's scared for his own life, runs to be with the other disciples in hiding. And he doesn't come out until he gets a report from Mary that Christ is alive. Does Jesus turn his back on Peter? No. God continues to love Peter. The disciples were in hiding. As Jesus was dying on the cross, but as he was dying on the cross, what did Jesus say? He said, forgive them. Forgive them. You know, many years ago, William Temple, who was the Archbishop of Canterbury, was asked to speak on the meaning of the cross. Temple chose two texts from the Bible. First, Genesis 1, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And Temple went on to explain, he said, you know, creating the universe for God, that was easy. God had no issue with that, no problem with that. But then he came to the second text, which was how Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane on the evening before he was crucified. And the scripture text says, his sweat became like great drops of blood. Templeton, the Archbishop of Canterbury, said, creating the universe, that was easy. But recreating humanity, that made God sweat blood. It's not so easy. Let's be honest, we don't get what we deserve, do we? When we fail to change, when we struggle to step out of the darkness into the light, even when we choose our own way instead of Jesus' way, God still loves us. God loves us no matter what. But God hopes. And God is always hoping that we will choose a new life. Will you? Think about it. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us stand and sing together.
We thank you for sharing with us in worship this day. Our graduates will be in Gunter Hall following our service, and we invite you to also make your way to Gunter Hall so that you can stop and speak a word of congratulations and affirmation to these young adults. Now our service of worship ends, and our worship through service begins. We go to love and serve the one who has first loved us. Amen.